Marcus Herzig with us. Marcus is a senior mentor who has been helping people digest fear for at least 20 years. Welcome, Marcus.
First of all, welcome. Here it is just morning. And most other places, there's, I see Danny sitting in the dark. So we have different time zones from Australia to South Africa to Europe, Middle Europe. Welcome, everybody. So we are living in quite intense and interesting times in the moment, which obviously also is might be part of our meeting this morning, which should include a guided meditation and then a little bit of talking and maybe also intertwined into the guided meditation. And so that you have some time to reflect on what I say. I certainly don't invite you to believe me, but listen and see what rings true to you and then maybe experiment with that. Because digesting fear feels like, okay, this is how what we learn and then we do it. We read 1 point, 2 point, 3 point, and then we are finished. It actually doesn't work like that. And then also, I have a situation going on because my heating is leaking. So the water is running down the wall. So sometime this morning, somebody will come, and I hope not in the next hour. But then I have to park you for a moment and see how we go on, so that you also kind of maybe take that into account already, that we might have an interruption. Okay, so let's start simply at the best point we can start, whatever we start. We start where we are. So you might get a feeling of simply the place, the spot, the location where you sit. And that already has to do most probably a lot with, say, digesting fear. Because I would guess that you have chosen a place you consider as safe. Or at least, let's say, as safe as possible according to planetary standards. You have chosen a place to be able to sit 1 hour, take your time, and not be on the run. So just for a moment, let's honor your ability to create a sufficiently safe space for what you're doing just now. And when I say that, some of our minds say, oh yeah, that's true. I created a sufficiently safe space. That's good. And it certainly will have a reaction in your physical body, in your emotions. But the mind of some of our meeting people here might say, oh no, it's not safe. This could happen, that could happen. And that we also maybe notice that safety has an inner component. So what your system got grounded in, embodied in, has learned. So that has a lot to do with our upbringing and the pre-experience. And something has to do really with the outside. And so maybe take a moment to check that for yourself. I would maybe call that the difference between fear and anxiety. So fear is, for example, when really something is happening. And anxiety is, I would call, a feeling you most probably know already. I know this feeling since whatever time. So anxiety is the wind of the past. It's like a sticker on your glasses. Wherever you will look, it is there. And wherever you will go, you will take it with you. And the other thing is something to act upon. The fear, so let's say an animal or a snake or whatever area you live, snakes are not so common here, but whatever can happen, a reality. So you need to run, to fight, to take care. And most probably, for the most of us, even in these times, it's more about the past. It's more about anxiety. It's more about a feeling of, or the assumption of not being safe. The assumption of not having a safe, secure place or support. And then, of course, our mind takes this sticker and clicks it to whatever situations. It might be Corona. This is, of course, in the moment, the thing to stick our anxiety to. But it might also be your car, your children, your grandchildren, your husband, your partner, whatever. And of course, the fear where we can run and fight, and the anxiety, these are, we need totally different tools for that. So one of the tools is to listen in presence. That might sound a little bit esoteric or like meditation, which partly it is, of course, but just by listening to me now and finding some centeredness and clarity in your inner process and focusing, most probably you might already notice that something in you is changing. In the moment, we look a little bit clearer at our inner and outer processes. But of course, this focus also works with, for example, distraction. When I work, I don't feel that. When I come home and have time, there it is. Maybe some of us know this thing. So let's look a little bit how we can meet our inner process, because most probably the outer process you anyway will take care. If there is something really acutely dangerous, you will run or fight, call the police, whatever is necessary. But then we have this inner process, and I want to offer some of the tools which prove working for me, so you can have a look and see. How is that landing in you? So one of the things we are just doing together is we come together with like-minded people and we start focusing and getting present. And so you might have a look if that works for you. You are already doing something to digest fear in a different way than maybe before. In the moment, you're most probably focusing and synchronizing onto me. So I'm the speaker in the moment, so you will relate to me. And as I design what I say and my voice and my transmission of presence, we also can notice that, for example, we can synchronize ourselves on catastrophe and problems or on competence. And as many of us have their camera on, you might just simply take a moment to look at these people here, which come together. These are people who make time in their lives to meet their inner world, their inner feelings, their inner state in a different way. Who at least consider that we can do something with that. Maybe not always as we like, but at least that there are some tools. So there is an openness for the inner world. So you have people here who have most probably already done something into this direction. Who have a competence in that. Who have enough time just now. Who have a secure place to do that, to have internet connection. So here are many competences sitting. And just for a moment, we can look at that. And then the mind says, how could I see and notice competence? And of course, we all do that in a different way. So just by the appearance of somebody, we trust the person or not. But this is also shadowed by our past experience. Oh, this person reminds me of my, let's say, ugly grandmother, grandfather, whatever. Oh, nothing to do with the person, but with my inner world. But there is also something in us where competence, what does that mean? That means that an ability, a potential in us got already embodied. There is a potential in energy. We can do, we manifest that in our life. We can do that. It's not just a potential, it's something we can do. That doesn't need to be perfect, whatever our mind would declare as perfect. But here are people who can do already a lot. Let's connect to that. And you might notice inside, oh, when I focus on the competence of people, how does that feel? How is that landing in your physical body? So what are the physical sensations of connecting consciously to competence? Which competence might Susan have, or Danny, or Michael, or Claire? And we meet that, this standing in ourselves. Competence means that we can offer a vessel, a foundation, a vessel for the energy of change. People want something from us, we read the news, we are motivated to do something. So we can embody information. Embodying information or having a vessel for information means it does not spill over. So most probably you might have seen that in children, that's very normal. Children need their parents to create this vessel when their feelings are spilling over. They cannot do that on their own. But also with us, we have that. When we are triggered with something, when we are in a fight with our children, our partners, our boss, ourselves. But there is also something like space. So we have enough space, the vessel, for this information. Even if we only have the possibility of, wow, I feel so activated. Wait a second, what is really true here? What is the outside? What is the inside? Don't Do I have a person I can relate to? Sit down for a moment, like we just do now, and look. But we're not always in a Zoom call. But you might have a person you know, somebody who is not so easy to impress. Somebody you would consider, oh, that's good to be with this person when there is trouble. And to have a feeling about this person. You can have it on our inner screen, have a look, have a feeling, hear the voice, something we can relate to. And just to compare, maybe some of you are on Facebook, on Twitter, read the news, watch the news in TV, and also see how do we feel when we connect to trouble, to, let's say, to incompetence, to people selling sensation for the sake of the sensation and the trouble. When we listen to maybe even on purpose disinformation. I just think, when I listen to that, my system reacts like this. When I tune in with the competence of the people here, my system reacts like that. So that as early as possible, we find something real. Let's say the inner world, the inner anxiety also, of course, feels real. It's very three-dimensional because it's like one of these video glasses. It's three-dimensional on our glasses. Wherever we look, it is. And we easily can fix it to everything outside. But it's, in a way, it's not true. It's an overlapping. So if you like, you can check for a moment. How do you notice your inner state just now after we are meeting for maybe nearly 20 minutes now? You listened a little bit to my voice and you tuned in with the competence. Maybe you already find a difference inside. And that's another thing I would invite you to try out. So when I ask you, how does this state now feel inside? What do you perceive in your physical body, for example? For some of us, the physical body is a safe harbor. Oh, I feel my body, I can ground in that. When my mind is all over the place, I pull my energy out of the mental frequency into the physical. I start feeling my body. So for some of us, that's easy. And for some of us, that might be not such a good tool. Because our pre-experience did not tell us our physical incarnation or physical embodiment is a safe place. So for some of us that works, and for some of us that doesn't work. But anyway, I want to invite you for a moment to have a scan. Maybe you start with your fingers, with your hands. And simply see if you can have a feeling, a perception of your hands, including the fingers. You have the right hand, the left hand. And you might notice that most probably the right and left hand feel different. not only that they feel different as a left and right hand, but they also might be accessible in a different way. So you might notice, oh, maybe my right hand appears on my inner landscape, my inner screen, and my left hand is a little bit foggy, numb, whatever, or maybe not. And then you might check a little bit more in detail. You might have a feeling of the left and right thumb. Do they appear the same or different in your inner landscape? So with your inner feeling, your inner sensations, perception, your inner looking. So some of us might be very visual and have kind of an inner picture, an inner knowing. Just check that for a moment. And again, maybe just to notice difference. And then you might have a look at the 8 fingers. Maybe one of these fingers sticks out. Oh, this finger I really easily can feel and access. Ah. So it's very clear on your inner screen, on your inner landscape. And there might be other fingers. Oh, I know they are there, of course, when I look, they are there, but on my inner feeling, do I really feel that? Can I really perceive that? Can I really land in my hand, in this finger, or is it a little bit like not there? And then, of course, I invite you not to push. Let's notice that feeling or feeling perception is as good as not feeling. So we notice, connection, feeling, perception, and not perception, not feeling. And especially the not feeling, to honor that. This is a tool of, let's say, modulating intensity. So maybe you can have a kind look at that and say, oh, that's interesting. My system seems to think that this, to feel this finger, to notice this finger is okay. But my system also says to connect to that finger, better not. Ah. And not to push against your own intelligence. Somehow your system has decided that. Not feeling. It's not that something is missing, but it's an action. Feeling is our normal state, so not feeling has a reason. It needs energy. It's a little bit like you have an air mattress and you push it underwater. Oh, no air mattress. Very good. Oh, no finger. Very good. So we don't have most probably the reason why that has happened, but it has happened. And maybe if you like, for a moment, just give yourself some time to notice feeling, perception, connection in one of your fingers. Oh, this finger kind of sticks out. It's easy. And then thank you very much to your body, to your inner system. And maybe you also can have a gentle look with soft eyes and friendliness at one of the fingers who don't appear so much on your inner screen, in your inner world. Ah, this is how not feeling feels. Not feeling is a competence. So as we started with, oh, out of some reason, I decided to not feel that. So fingers are, of course, also subject to kind of accidents or bruises or something. So we have no idea where that comes from, most probably. But it's a probability for you to just notice, oh, this is how not feeling appears. And don't push in. It's a little bit like you knock on the door of your neighbor and the neighbor doesn't open, so you most probably don't push through the door. Ah, not feeling. When it's a finger, if you like, you can, for example, go a little bit upward into the hand or the arm, and you might even notice where not feeling starts and where feeling ends. And if you like, you can take two or three deeper breaths and we might come together like we switch a little bit into connection to people mode, if you like. That's a very different function of our system. So most probably you also noticed that just now. Well, when I was totally with myself, I pulled my energy into my inner world, into perception, out of my thinking program, out of my mind, into a different frequency of physical. My system felt like that. But now when you start looking, that's very different. So you're opening the window, the door, to a much bigger world. And this bigger world has more intensity. And I really invite you to take a moment to digest that. We are so used to just open our eyes and then stand under all circumstances what's coming in. Because we needed that as children. We needed to go to school. We needed to be with our family, with our siblings, with our parents, with our teachers, with our peers. We need it to stay. And I invite you for a moment also to experiment. Oh, when you close your eyes, that might again be different. And I don't say that closing eyes for everybody is better. For some of us, closing eyes means to be alone. That might for some of us be not a good place. So we need the outer world to connect to. To make safety. We have learned through our upbringing that we need the others, which for children is healthy and normal in a good way. But if it's still, when you're so dependent as adults, it's interesting. There is something going on in the background. But anyway, it's not about psychotherapy in the moment. It's about noticing. And of course, when you are inclined, to connect to people to make safety, then, for example, the social distancing will hit you. That's something you need to take into account, let's say. Your system will react to that as danger. And for some of us, closing eyes is so good, to keep the world out, to be alone. For some of us, the social distancing is just like a holiday. When it's not a year, it's fine. These people are not so impacted by that. They are maybe even more relaxed. And this is not about good or bad. This is more about the programming in our childhood. So we don't have a choice here. We are not fully adult in that. Adult means to be able to be alone and to be able to be with people. And when it's finished, it's finished. But maybe we also find some, let's say, dependencies here, let's say, or felt or perceived dependence. So that maybe for yourself, you also can have a deeper look what you can expect, what it might be good for you to take care about. So when you're more dependent on relation, then it's also good to take care of that. To call people, to have Zoom calls, Skype calls, but also maybe a physical connection according to what is possible in your area. And for the other people, so the social distancing plays into their pattern of safety making. Maybe also to notice, look, I can see my pattern more clearly. That's also not free. It's only that, let's say, our distortion is a little bit more easy to cope with the situation, but that's not freedom. So what it means to digest fear is, first of all, intrapersonal, so inside of your system. This is what we looked into the first moments. So when I invited you to look at the competence of people, most probably that creates safety. It engages our adult discrimination, discernment. As children, we have to hope that our parents are competent. As adults, we can look, this works, this doesn't work. I think I would rely on this person in this, but not so much in that. So we have a discernment. We don't need to buy the whole package. So when we do this exercise, we relate to our inner competence of an adult. And also in the moment I relate to your competence, my child places, which are not yet integrated, will relax because it's great to have competent parents. As children, we are very, let's say, programmed to look at the things which don't work in the family system and take care of that because it's our safety. So I really would invite you to experiment, if you like, with this looking at the competence. This is not denying what doesn't work. This is absolutely not what I say. But for example, in the family or in a team when you're still working, when you really focus on the competence, or when you're kind of starting into a fight with your children or with your partner. With children, it's different. We need to tune in with our own competence. But when we are going to come into a fight with a colleague, with a partner, that's good. Look at the competence first. Otherwise, we go into the emergency switch of our childhood, taking care of what doesn't work. But that was not freedom. That was an act of emergency. It will, in an instant, throw us into danger and difficulty and fear. So looking at the competence will set to peace much easier. Then I invited you to go more inside. That means that to start with, it might be difficult because our mind is all over the place and having a lot of, let's say, energy. So I invited you to go out of that. That's to start with somehow difficult sometimes because the mind tells us, oh, when I think, you're safe. But actually, that's not really safety. That's overriding a feeling of fear. So the safety in the thinking is the not feeling. When our mind is overactivated, it's not in the service of having a good idea and be creative and find out something. It's more in the service of not feeling. So I push my energy from feeling into thinking. It's a different frequency. Like, oh, I don't like this radio station. I switch to another one. Ah, there the music is better. And many of us discover that as children. So I invited you for some time into the physical body. I did not invite you so much into your emotions. So it's more about a safe harbor in the physical. So we lower our frequency, things get a little bit slower. The physical is more dense, more inert than the mind. The mind is ultra fast. So we can kind of arrive a little bit more. We are starting to synchronize. Oh, this is my physical sensation. And the physical sensation is, let's say, like a foundation for feelings and thinking. When we land more in the physical, when you did this exercise, you might probably notice that the mind gets more quiet. That's not that you quietened your mind. It's only that you redirected the energy where it belongs. This is my physical sensation. These are my feelings. And this is what I think about it. The synchronization of these three, let's say, realms of reality. The physical world, the emotional world, and the mental world. They need to work together, but they are not the same. But sometimes our mind takes over out of a good compensative idea of the past. It was helpful, but it will keep us in a little bit overactivated state. So also that we might notice, it's possible to consciously direct my presence into certain areas. And in that, I also want to highlight a little bit the feeling, the sensation, and the not feeling, the not sensation. So we have the ability to numb certain areas of our system. If it's too much, we fade that out. So especially in situations when the energy is high and we are a little bit on the edge, come to a place inside of you. So we did it with the 10 fingers. Most probably in the finger, you can easily feel, easily access. There is not so much trauma stored in that. So for some of us, the body is a trauma storage. In the moment we start reconnecting to that, we get even more active. So don't go into too big areas of feeling. So feel your body, that's good. Not necessarily. For some of us, it's good. And if you're in a more clean area, it's also good. But if the area is stored, there is a storage, then it's not such a good idea. But for example, a very small place, like just the tip of one finger, if you can really feel that, the system will anyway calm down because this place is safe. This place does not tell you danger. So some of our body, physical body places are like a fridge. We have stored something for later. We couldn't digest it in the moment it came up, in our childhood, in an accident, in something, whatever. So feeling the body will heat that up. So in a situation where it's anyway a little bit, let's say, challenging, it's not such a good idea to experiment too much with that. So in this case, maybe you can make an inner note. Oh, this finger felt very easy to access. And then from there, we opened our eyes. So my relation to myself, we opened to you. My relation with you. And if you like, you can simply check for a moment. There are some pictures of people. And when you look at them, you also will feel at them. And you might notice how your system interacts. Some of us might like that, we reach out. Some of us might not like, we go internally back. Harden ourselves a little bit not to feel so much. So it's also absolutely okay to experiment with that. To notice what brings safety for you. As it's about digesting fear, that also means that we are looking as a group now together, how can we expand the range of our abilities? Because what you already can do anyway, also without me. But then also to notice, how does my system create sufficient safety with you? Am I more the pulling back type and thank you very much? Am I more free and I can go back and forth on this I like, this I don't like? Or am I more the I need to jump on the other person and take care type? And especially the jump out and take care types will have a lot of invitations in the last time. So that's a, let's say, a challenging way of making safety. It might have worked in your family once, but now it might be draining. So most probably we learn these roles in our family. How do we find our place in the family system? And then how can we come back? Digesting fear means, in the end, I am able to feel it. I'm able to feel it without so much contraction. I don't say that contraction is wrong. Contraction is better than ticking out, than being overwhelmed. But then after some time, I feel fear and I need to run, so run. I feel anxiety. Can I give that a little bit of space and do I notice, I don't have to do something about it? And that's very important. The clarity of, I don't need to do something about it. That's the healing place. Just surviving your own fear and trying to feel it will only stress you totally out. So just feeling it, so that sometimes, feel your fear. That doesn't work. Because your whole system will support the stress process. Your mind will tell you that this fear is justified. You need to be afraid because of do-do-do, and the whole story comes up and your physical system is all over the place and your hormones and your neurotransmitters are all over the place. Let's notice when there is anxiety. Some of us might feel that in the chest, in the belly, in the solar plexus somewhere. Can I connect to that feeling, not dive into it and drown, but can I connect and notice, I don't need to do something about it? And it's very intelligent to train that, for example, in groups like that or on your own. It's not so easy when you're in the middle of the challenge. But when you have trained it, it will reach into the challenges more and more. So if you like, for a moment, you can have a look. Is there an area of your body where you feel, let's say, more energy? Where you feel more aliveness? And you don't need to like it or dislike it. You just notice, oh, well, there is activity, like an inner vibration, like a feeling you can name, a sensation you can name, a tingling, electric feeling, whatever, like a aliveness. And when you touch that, just stay there for a moment. Or do I need to do something about that? Or is it okay when it feels like that? If you have the feeling of I like it, it's easy. And when you dislike it, it might be a little bit an interesting step. Oh, I feel this feeling. I have these, let's say, butterflies in my solar plexus, or I have this thing around my heart. Oh, do I need to do something about it? That's very important, because this is the gap between you and identification. Do I need to do something about it is the vessel for the energy. Your presence is bigger than the energy. Standing it, you're lost. Then better distract or whatever, stand on your head. Distract yourself, have a coffee, do something, whatever works for you. But there is, let's say, when we are more in social interaction, so this feeling comes up. And so long as I can say that, I have space. Safety comes through space. Safety comes through the space to be able to say, this is what I feel, and I don't need to do something about it. This is what I feel, it's uncomfortable. But first of all, let's listen to my partner. Let's listen to my boss, let's listen to my employee, whatever, my children. And then even our reactions are not so. So when we are totally reactive, there is an action on the outside, a trigger, dong, and my system reacts, tuk, tuk. This ping pong between partners, you most probably know that. At least you have seen it in other people. But there is maybe something like a space. Oh, this is what I notice. Wow, my inner system tells me I need to defend and, okay. Can I give that some space? Like I said, now with this aliveness, can I just have that without needing to do something about that? Do I have more space than information, more space than energy? Safety is in the space. As children, we learn that the safety is in the parents, in the other people. Or safety is in my room. Safety is in structure. Safety is in things or in people. But that doesn't work. That works for children in good circumstances. And there it's appropriate. But as adults, it's good that we start looking for space. The space to be able to say, where do I need to act? Where do I not need to act? And then in the space, there is this feeling of safety. I can take my place. I can take my space. And maybe if that speaks to you, give yourself a moment to maybe notice it now in our meeting here, some kind of a spaciousness. Your mind gets a little bit quiet. Even if you're a little bit distracted, so some of you are also in a surrounding where you are interacting with, then there is the action, and then sometimes I could get really tired and I want to defend or have it away, and okay, this is my reaction, and then can we give space again? There might have been an emotional reaction, anger, fear, shame, whatever. And for a moment, let's share the spaciousness. Notice how that feels inside of you, but also that's then the next step, I and we. When we share the space, that might include tons of information, of course. We all have tons of abilities and competences and things going on. But we also share a space together. And you can allow yourself the space of our spaciousness and also for the others. So we are, it kind of is more a soft focus. That's nothing like that the mind can really do. Our mind only can think one object, another object, and he can think about a group feeling. But group feeling is a group feeling, it's not a group thinking. So where is a spaciousness? We have a, there's a kind of a, it's not really a sensation, but there is something we notice, space, silence. And for the moment, let's have this silence together. The new, the future comes through silence. Safety comes through silence. It manifests in energy, but it comes through silence. It comes through space. The new idea comes in. We notice it is new. A new possibility has not been there before. I cannot think that, but my mind can notice it. There's a certain space. And you might allow your physical body to rest for a moment in this space, spaciousness, silence. You might notice your emotional body being active. And you might also notice your mind being active. But none of all these informations fills the whole space. Oh, this is what I think. There's space around that. This is what I feel, what I perceive. There is space. Feelings are movements of energy. When I notice it comes up and I don't grasp it, I don't do something with it, you will notice it rises and it gets smaller again and it dies. It's finished. It disappears. Then the mind of, wow, I was so angry. Where is it? It's gone. If we have a lot of piled up feelings from our past, stored anger, stored fear, then of course it looks like, oh, it doesn't end for some time, but that's not true. It will end. But that's another story. That's not for now. Yeah, from my side, thank you very much. You can have a look what you can take with you out of our meeting here, how your self-connection, your connection to others, and your connection in a group will work for you or against you, against for you, works for you or against, also for others and against others. What we synchronize on, do we synchronize on stress? Or do we consciously synchronize on competence that needs some consciousness, needs a decision most probably, because we are so easily pulled into the stress, because this is what we need to take care of. Our Stone Age brain takes that as survival. so that we can decide again a little bit and then open. So from my side, thank you very much and have a wonderful day. Stay healthy and enjoy.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Marcus.
Thank you very much.
I'm able to feel it without so much contraction. I don't say that contraction is wrong. Contraction is better than ticking out, than being overwhelmed. But then after some time, oh, I feel fear and I need to run, so run. I feel anxiety. Can I give that a little bit of space and do I notice, oh, I don't have to do something about it? And that's very important. The clarity of, oh, I don't need to do something about it. That's the healing place. Just surviving your own fear and trying to feel it will only stress you totally out. So just feeling it, so that sometimes, oh, feel your fear. That doesn't work. Because your whole system will support the stress process. your mind will tell you that this fear is justified. You need to be afraid because of do-do-do, and the whole story comes up, and your physical system is all over the place, and your hormones and your neurotransmitters are all over the place. Let's notice when there is anxiety. Some of us might feel that in the chest, in the belly, in the solar plexus somewhere. Oh, can I connect to that feeling, not dive into it and drown, but can I connect and notice, oh, I don't need to do something about it. And it's very intelligent to train that, for example, in groups like that or on your own. It's not so easy when you're in the middle of the challenge. But when you have trained it, it will reach into the challenges more and more. So if you like, for a moment, you can have a look. Is there an area of your body where you feel, let's say, more energy? Where you feel more aliveness? And you don't need to like it or dislike it. You just notice, oh, well, there is activity, like an inner vibration, like a feeling you can name, a sensation you can name, a tingling, electric feeling, whatever, like a aliveness. And when you touch that, just stay there for a moment. Oh, do I need to do something about that? Or is it okay when it feels like that? If you have the feeling of I like it, it's easy. And when you dislike it, it might be a little bit an interesting step. Oh, I feel this feeling. I have these, let's say, butterflies in my solar plexus, or I have this thing around my heart. Oh, do I need to do something about it? That's very important, because this is the gap between you and identification. Do I need to do something about it is the vessel for the energy. Your presence is bigger than the energy. Standing it, you're lost. Then better distract or whatever, stand on your head. Distract yourself, have a coffee, do something, whatever works for you. But there is, let's say, when we are more in social interaction, so this feeling comes up. As long as I can say that, I have space. Safety comes through space. Safety comes through the space to be able to say, this is what I feel, and I don't need to do something about it. This is what I feel, it's uncomfortable. But first of all, let's listen to my partner. Let's listen to my boss, let's listen to my employee, whatever, my children. And then even our reactions are not so. So when we are totally reactive, there is an action on the outside, a trigger, dong, and my system reacts, tuk, tuk. This ping pong between partners, you most probably know that. At least you have seen it in other people. But there is maybe something like a space. Oh, this is what I notice. Wow, my inner system tells me I need to defend and, okay. Can I give that some space? Like I said, now with this aliveness, can I just have that without needing to do something about that? Do I have more space than information, more space than energy? Safety is in the space. As children, we learn that the safety is in the parents, in the other people. Or safety is in my room. Safety is in structure. Safety is in things or in people. But that doesn't work. That works for children in good circumstances. And there it's appropriate. But as adults, it's good that we start looking for space. The space to be able to say, where do I need to act? Where do I not need to act? And then in the space, there is this feeling of safety. I can take my place. I can take my space. And maybe if that speaks to you, give yourself a moment to maybe notice it now in our meeting here, some kind of a spaciousness. Your mind gets a little bit quiet. Even if you're a little bit distracted, so some of you are also in a surrounding where you are interacting with, then there is the action, and then sometimes I could get really tired and I want to defend or have it away, and okay, this is my reaction, and then can we give space again? There might have been an emotional reaction, anger, fear, shame, whatever. And for a moment, let's share the spaciousness. Notice how that feels inside of you, but also that's then the next step, I and we. When we share the space, that might include tons of information, of course. We all have tons of abilities and competences and things going on. But we also share a space together. And you can allow yourself the space of our spaciousness and also for the others. So we are, it kind of is more a soft focus. That's nothing like that the mind can really do. Our mind only can think one object, another object, and he can think about a group feeling. But a group feeling is a group feeling. It's not a group thinking. So where is a spaciousness? We have a, there's kind of a, it's not really a sensation, but there is something we notice, space, silence. And for the moment, let's have this silence together. The new, the future comes through silence. Safety comes through silence. It manifests in energy, but it comes through silence. It comes through space. A new idea comes in. We notice it is new. A new possibility has not been there before. I cannot think that, but my mind can notice it. There's a certain space. And you might allow your physical body to rest for a moment in this space, spaciousness, silence. You might notice your emotional body being active. And you might also notice your mind being active. But none of all these informations fills the whole space. Oh, this is what I think. There's space around that. This is what I feel, what I perceive. There is space. Feelings are movements of energy. When I notice it comes up and I don't grasp it, I don't do something with it, you will notice it rises and it gets smaller again and it dies. It's finished. It disappears. And the mind of, I was so angry, where is it? It's gone. If we have a lot of piled up feelings from our past, stored anger, stored fear, then of course it looks like, it doesn't end for some time, but that's not true, it will end. But that's another story. That's not for now. Yeah, from my side, thank you very much. You can have a look what you can take with you out of our meeting here, how your self-connection, your connection to others, and your connection in a group will work for you or against you, works for you or against others and against others. What we synchronize on, do we synchronize on stress? Or do we consciously synchronize on competence that needs some consciousness, needs a decision most probably, because we are so easily pulled into the stress, because this is what we need to take care of. Our Stone Age brain takes that as survival. So that we can decide again a little bit and then open. So from my side, thank you very much and have a wonderful day. Stay healthy and enjoy.